Welcome to the Planning Commission meeting for the City of Pacifica for Monday, April 18th, 2016. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Berenger.
Here.
Commissioner Evans.
Present.
Commissioner Gordon.
Here.
Commissioner Campbell.
Here.
Commissioner Niblin.
Here.
Commissioner Cooper.
Here.
Commissioner Clifford.
Here.
All commissioners are present and we have a quorum.
Thank you. Thank you. Salute to the flag. I'll lead it.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, on to administrative business, approval of the order of agenda. Okay, Commissioner Clifford.
I move that we approve the order of agenda.
Commissioner Cooper.
I second the motion.
Had a motion and a second. Please vote. And that passes unanimously. Next up, approval of the minutes for the March 21st meeting. Okay, Commissioner Gordon.
I move that we approve the minutes for the March 21st meeting.
Okay, Commissioner Niblin.
I'll second that motion.
Okay, we've had a motion and a second. Please vote. And that passes unanimously by those present. Designation of a liaison to the City Council meeting for April 25th.
So this was put back on the agenda because the original designee was Commissioner Vaterlas. However, so we need to redesignate somebody, and I wanted to point out that the hearing date is now May 9th, and the two items are the appeal of the Anchor Inn at Pedro Point, as well as appeal of a single-family home on Stanley in Pedro Point.
So all that, so April 25th is the...
April 25th is on the agenda. However, since then, the hearing date has moved to May 9th.
Okay.
So that's the date we're looking for a designee.
And it's for three?
For two items.
Two items.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Any volunteers?
I'll volunteer.
All right. Commissioner Niblin, you are on. On to oral communications. This portion of the agenda is available to the public to address the Planning Commission on any issue within the subject matter jurisdiction of the Commission that is not on tonight's agenda. The time allowed for any speaker will be 3 minutes. If you want to speak on something that's not on the agenda tonight, there were cards in the back. You could fill them out. There's still time. Not seeing movement. All right. We're going to move on then. Moving on to the first public hearing, and it is a site development permit, use permit, coastal development permit, and parking exception filed by the applicant, Gordon Tanura, on behalf of the property owner, Shirley Gibbs, to place a one-story, 840-square-foot modular structure and a 225-square-foot of decking onto an existing 5,600-square-foot lot at 1809 Palmetto Avenue. At the site commonly known as the Pacifica Resource Center. The recommended California Environmental Quality Act or CEQA status tonight is a categorical exemption, and the proposed action for the commission is to approve as conditioned.
Excuse me, Chair, before we start, I want to let know that some years ago I was on the advisory committee of the PRC, and I initially, when I was asked about looking into the first steps of this project, I went down to the planning department and talked to Catherine for a few minutes, but have stopped at that point after that, and I think I can completely have an open mind on this subject. So I just wanted to let everybody know. Thank you.
All right.
Chair, excuse me.
Commissioner Clifford.
I want to let everybody know that at one point in time, one of the employees of the resource center asked me to place a bid on installing the container. But I did not place a bid, and I have no vested interest in the project.
Thank you. Okay. Any other commissioners? Okay. All right. Staff report, please.
Good evening, Honorable Chair and Commissioners. I'm Associate Planner Christian Murdoch from the Planning Department. This is a small project to install a modular building on an existing site adjacent to the existing Pacifica Resource Center. The portion of the lot is currently vacant and would be connected with a new deck installation between the existing structure and the new modular structure. The project would allow the PRC to improve its operations with this addition to its facility. Currently, it's bursting at the seams, as some of you are aware, and allowing them to expand into this space wouldn't change the nature of their operation, but would allow them to provide a higher level of service and a better quality experience to the recipients of its services. Staff believes that the project would result in an overall enhancement to the site that would reduce some of the conflicts that exist with in terms of material storage, provision of services. It would allow additional confidentiality, would increase accessibility of the services to persons with disabilities. And so overall, staff is very supportive of the application and hopes the commission finds the same support. The project requires a site development permit due to the 50% increase in floor area. It's a requirement in the city's site development permit standards for review of that entitlement on that basis. Additionally, it requires a use permit because this project is abutting a residential zone and because it's a non-visitor serving use in the coastal zone, and a change of use with this expansion into the new area of the lot, which also requires a use permit. And it additionally requires a parking exception. The new floor area for the modular building installation would require one parking space under the city's parking standards. As you're aware, the site is very small and severely constrained for provision of on-site parking. And so the applicant has also requested a parking exception to waive the requirement for the one space. So for the reasons identified in the staff report and the attached resolution and conditions, staff recommends Planning Commission approval of the project as conditioned and finding that it's exempt from the California Environmental Quality Act. Thank you.
Okay, questions for staff? Thank you. All right, Commissioner Cooper.
I was curious about, has anybody looked at the noise requirements for this particular lot and where it sits, and specifically the mechanical systems? I was kind of concerned if there was a restriction on where this mechanical systems would be, knowing that it's probably an outdoor unit somewhere.
No, that issue has not been addressed, and the applicant perhaps can address that during his comments.
Perfect. Thank you.
Okay. Commissioner Neblin.
Thank you. Just a clarification I'd like to get, and it pertains to the requirement for a use permit. And it looks like in any event, because there are two different subsections that are implicated here, a use permit's going to be needed. But I was interested in what actually constitutes a change of use for projects located in the coastal zone. I mean, I understand that we're putting some new structures or a new structure in place, but, you know, other parts of the staff report there, you know, it's seems pretty clear to me that we're really not talking about an intensification of use. I mean, we're talking about serving the same number of clients, essentially, in a better configured and sort of more rationalized space. So I guess I'm a little unclear on why, you know, we need a use permit pursuant to sub J. And maybe a lot of this comes to what an intensification of use or change of use means under the Coastal Act, but it doesn't strike me that there's a change in use here. It seems like the same use.
So staff's assessment on that was to be very conservative with the entitlements that were required. The portion of the site where this installation is proposed is vacant and has not been initiated for any type of use so far as staff can tell. So for that reason, given its proximity to residences and given the fact that it has never been in commercial or nonprofit use before, we conservatively applied that to ensure there was no gap in the entitlements.
I see. Okay.
But it's certainly not, as staff has assessed, a change in use significantly from what's at the existing portion of the site, nor a significant intensification of the use.
Well, I guess I'd say in my perspective, this is an extraordinary abundance of caution step. I don't myself think there's a change of use.
Commissioner Evans.
No, it's not.
Oh, that's not me. Commissioner Berenger?
Yes.
All right.
I just had two quick questions. The first one is concerning, I understand there's a substantial number of clients that visit the facility that are handicapped. I was wondering if staff had looked into possibly designating a handicap on-street parking space for that purpose so that they would be able to easily access the handicap ramps. And then I also had a question about the noise. If there are any refrigeration units, for example, in connection with the food that they store, they may have only all dry type food and maybe they don't have it, but if they do, I would ask that staff would possibly look into where the placement of those units are, because it does abut a residential property And I could see where that could be problematic for the person who lives there. And then the third question is, on the windows that face the residential property, there's a fence there. It doesn't look as though it's high enough to possibly block that, so you could have people looking into their backyard. Perhaps as a condition, they could maybe increase the height of that fence to give the people that live there a little bit more privacy. Those are my only questions.
Okay.
So similarly to Commissioner Cooper's inquiry about the mechanical equipment, we did not specifically analyze any commercial grade refrigeration equipment that might be required. It's not my understanding that the resource center's use relies on that. I believe they just use regular refrigerators and so forth, but we can certainly verify and ensure that if that's an issue, we take appropriate measures with respect to placement.
All right.
Regarding the fence, there is a 6-foot height limit for fences in this zoning district, so to the extent that there is room to increase the height, we can discuss that with the applicant.
Okay.
But to exceed that would require a different entitlement that's not on the agenda for consideration this evening.
Okay.
Okay. Commissioner Cooper.
Thanks, Chair. I have one more question for you. Noticing this is, you know, obviously the food bank, and there's going to be quite a few deliveries to this food bank, I would assume, throughout the duration. Has there been any consideration with loading and unloading in the public area and streets, and do they have an idea maybe of how much time it would take to unload? I mean, obviously, we're talking about a lot of exchange of items here.
I guess I would point out that, again, this is an intensification of what's already happening, so I don't anticipate that the truck deliveries will increase.
Okay.
And I'll ask the applicant when he comes up to speak to that.
Perfect. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay. I don't see any more questions for staff. So at this point, we could have the applicant come up, and you have 10 minutes.
Okay. Can everybody fine?
Yes.
My name is Gordon Tenura. Thank you for listening to me today and for considering this application. Joining me today is Anita Reese, who's the executive director of the Resource Center. Chris and Shirley Gibbs, who are our landlords and supporting the project. And what I'd like to do is provide a little background, a little more than what's been provided already, talk about some of the activities that got us to this point, answer some of those questions that have been raised already, and I think we've got responses for those. So indeed, the PRC, Pacifica Resource Center, provides a lot of services, but predominantly the food program sticks out in both in the volume and the number of residents that it serves, in the thousands every year. Indeed, the space is constrained now. The pantry is supported in two small rooms, and during food distribution days and otherwise, staff and volunteers are literally on top of each other in serving the various people. You've also seen people, if you drive by there on some afternoons, lined up outside waiting for those services. This project will also support a more comfortable setting for those clients as they wait for the food services. What started this actually was Commissioner Clifford referenced a container, and one of the ideas originally was to place a refashioned sea container to provide additional storage. And the Second Harvest Food Bank came forward with a grant to enable us to do that. However, in looking to that was going to be a rather clumsy and not particularly pretty installation there on Palmetto. We were encouraged by our landlords, Chris Gibbs, to consider other things we might do. That got us to thinking about a modular unit that we might be able to place on the property, portable in a sense, in that in the event that the resource center should move, we'd be able to still have that asset, and something more fully functional to support primarily the food program, but other aspects as well, or provide relief for other aspects of the many programs the resource center conducts. The Second Harvest Food Bank actually increased their grant to $100,000 for us. However, with the stipulation that we need to use those funds by June 30th. So I've been a bit under the gun in order to complete this process and actually the installation, but actually I think we can do it. So we're on project right now. So the number of activities we've done, we've collaborated quite closely with the planning staff They've been wonderful in support of this, in taking a novice through all the steps that I had to learn about in order to get to this point. We worked with the fire authority, with the building authority as well for those requirements. The unit will have fire protection, fire sprinklers in it, so we have to design and plan for that. We've had expert assistance from a landscape architect as well as a an architect who was on the San Mateo Planning Commission in the past. So we've tried to use, tried to show that we understand what needs to get done and can get it done. We also, when I submitted the application, we did put out a letter to neighbors, to the surrounding homeowners, telling them what our project was, providing them with views of what we had in terms of the site plan and elevation views, and soliciting any type of response. We received none. I understand a couple of people came to the planning department, and they can attest to whether or not there were anything substantive there, but I understood that they were just quick questions and easily answered. We've also done a competitive process for attaining the particular modular unit. We've selected a vendor to do that, and we've had the design now approved, and that is at the state now to certify. Actually, the unit has to go through a stringent state certification process, not only in the design, but actually in inspecting it, that it meets state standards. And so that will be done prior to it being shipped here on site for installation. The installation work itself entails, besides just moving it on site, hooking up plumbing, electrical, and we will do other, as you see in the design, decking, ramps, walkways, etc. Now, as to some of the questions that have been asked so far, in terms of the noise and in particular refrigeration, we currently have two refrigerators and a freezer in the current unit, and we'll be transferring those, but they are standard refrigerators and freezers. Nothing of a large walk-in refrigeration that requires a separate power unit and refrigeration and things of that nature. We may add a refrigerator or two, but it will all be run on the standard electrical circuit. These portable units, you probably have seen them before in a variety of different situations. The city has them for childcare, for example. They have their all of the HVAC, electrical, et cetera, on an end of the unit, in this case, in the back of the property. I'm not aware that there's anything, any type of noise in particular that's generated by those, other than what you would expect from even a standard home. In terms of the fence height, we've discussed this with Chris Gibbs. He recognizes, in fact, he is the owner of the property that is next to us there. He recognized what that might do to his tenant and has volunteered perhaps to put additional screening at the top of the fence for privacy. In terms of access, noted that it is, we have designed everything to be ADA compliant, including the restroom, also the walkways, the ramps, and so everything should be clear in terms of that. The in terms of loading, indeed, there is no additional provision of food that will be accorded this, but in recognition of the loading requirements, we've done in planning the size of the ramps and walkways, and even the door in which we'll be unloading food will be wider than your standard door in order to facilitate the loading. So we think it's going to be a much more efficient process. The majority of the unit will be the food program. Almost all of the food program will be serviced through this new unit, releasing much needed space for these other programs in the existing unit. I think that's it for your questions. I've reviewed the comments from staff regarding the conditions. I don't see anything that we haven't already or can't satisfy in the construction, so we have no objection at all to any of those conditions. So, questions?
Thank you. Okay, any questions for the applicant? Commissioner Cooper?
Thank you, Chair. First of all, I think that, you know, I praise you guys for expanding it. I think it serves a vital need within our community, especially for food distribution. And I only bring up the questions because I am concerned with the other neighbors that are around there, and I want to make sure that everybody is taken care of as far as noise and whatnot and safety. I'm just bringing this up. Maybe it's not an issue for you. I do see that you have a handicap ramp into the front. I do know that Spindrift had to put another handicap ramp into the opposite side, to the back of the building. So you have one entrance and one exit for a handicap ramp. So I'm just bringing it up as a cautionary measure to maybe look into to make sure you don't get caught, because they kind of were caught, I think. That's it. Besides that, thank you for providing services to our community.
Can I ask, in terms of that ADA compliance, would that be something that the building official will be checking on?
Yes, that would be. He's the one that wanted it. So.
Okay. At the back of the, I think the current plan shows an end of that back ramp. We had planned to put stairs, but I don't, or walkway. We planned to put stairs, but I think we can also facilitate that with a ramp.
Yeah, just be aware. I don't want you to get caught by surprise. So just maybe ask the question. It might not be an issue for you, but just bring it up.
I'll be visiting with him tomorrow, assuming that we get approval tonight.
All right. Any more questions for the applicant? I don't see any, so stay tuned. We might have some more for you at the end of the public hearing.
Thanks for your consideration.
Thank you. Okay. I'm going to open this item up to public hearing. If anyone wishes to speak on this topic, please fill out a card in the back. You'll have 3 minutes. I've got one card. John Keener.
Good evening, commissioners. I'm city councilman and the council liaison to the Pacifica Resource Center board. And I'm speaking as an individual, not representing necessarily the council. First of all, I want to welcome the newly appointed commissioners and also say that, something that we don't often get a chance to say on city council, and that is thank you for your service. Of course, I support the new modular unit. It will house mainly the food pantry, and the decking between it and the existing building, which will provide a place for clients to wait instead of waiting on the sidewalk. Not many applicants are doing the work on the application pro bono, but Gordon Tenura is, and he has guided this project through the planning phase and will continue it through the execution phase. So we thank him. And we thank the owners, the Gibbs family, Chris and Shirley, for their support. We thank the Second Harvest Food Bank for a grant for the modular unit itself. The planning department has been a big help in informing Gordon what the regulations are and what he'll have to meet. And the city has approved a grant of about $13,000 to cover the cost of the permits for the resource center. So we look forward to these improvements. They will help the Resource Center better serve its clients. And I thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Susan Tocolo.
Good evening. I be brief. I'm wearing three hats today. I'm a resident of Pacifica. I'm a supporter of the Pacifica Resource Center, and I'm representing Second Harvest Food Bank. And as Second Harvest Food Bank, we are really excited about this project and the ability to help support Pacifica residents, the low-income people who live here in Pacifica, by having an expansion and a more welcoming and a potential for privacy and all the kinds of things that this building will, this module unit, will add to the resource center. So I'm just here to urge you to approve their application.
Thank you. Okay, I don't have any more cards up here on this topic, so I'm going to close the public hearing and, well, the applicant wishes to respond to the public comments. Hate to put you on the spot. All right. Okay, I'm going to bring this back to the commission for deliberation. Commissioner Evans?
Thank you, Chair. With my time, as I guess it's almost a couple of years of working with them on the advisory board, I saw their dire needs, and this space was one major dire need. There was times that the corridors were full of stuff, so this is truly a needed item. I fully stand behind it. I think it's a very smart, very great, good idea, and very, what's the right word? It just, from what I first heard about it, it was the container, and this is a much, much better idea. The use of this will greatly support their clients. I mean them, but they support their clients. So I think it's a great idea. That's just the bottom line.
Thank you. All right, Commissioner Clifford.
Yeah, I wanted to say that, first off, I'll start out with, when this comes up for the vote, I am going to be voting for it. I do want to thank the Resource Center for all the efforts that they put in, and I think that this modular will not only assist their clients, but will also make their job easier, make it easier for them to actually do the job that they are there and working so hard to do. So kudos to them, and thank you much.
Okay, Commissioner Neblin.
Thank you. Like my colleagues, I'm in, at least colleagues who have spoken so far, I'm in support of this project. I've had a chance in the course of my work with the county to become more familiar with the important stuff that these community-based organizations like Pacifica Resource Center do, and I'm just really pleased just to see the various agencies come together to make this happen. I wanted to note as well, notwithstanding my comment of earlier, I think staff put together a really great staff report, made it very easy for me on a Saturday night, frankly, prior to having a drink, to flip through this and really understand quickly kind of what's at issue. Very easy project to support when we get a report like this.
All right. Thank you. Commissioner Gordon.
Thank you, Chair. Yeah, I'll definitely be voting for this project. Many thanks to the Second Harvest Food Bank for their grant. It's rare that we have an application here that's so easy to vote in favor of, but this is one of them, and thanks for everybody's pro bono work on this as well. And also, like Commissioner Neblin said, you guys did a great job putting together the package. And I'm ready to make a motion unless I see other people. Other lights.
I got one item. I just want to follow up on Commissioner Berenger's remark on the windows that might face the neighboring residential structure. And I, cognizant of the 6-foot fence height limit, is there any opportunity? What's the rule on privacy screening for like a tree or something like that there? Is there room for that, or applicant?
I just want to note there isn't a window that looks directly into that yard. The window, if you look at the diagram, is in the front of the unit. So there is a walkway past that fence, but there's not a window per se.
Okay.
This is at the this is being placed at the level of the current property, of the current unit. So it is an existing, you might call it an existing condition today.
Okay. Thank you for clarifying that. Okay, Commissioner Clifford.
Well, what I was going to suggest is if there was a window back there, that we just asked for it to be an obscure glass, and that would have taken care of any privacy issues. But there isn't, so I don't have to ask for that.
Okay, Commissioner Gordon.
Okay, if there's no more comments from commissioners, I'm ready to make a motion.
Okay.
Move that the Planning Commission find that the project is exempt from CEQA, approve site development permit PSD-807-16, coastal development permit CDP-363-16, use permit UP-73-16, and parking exception PE-165-16 by adopting the attached resolution for the proposed placement of a modular structure with attached decking at 1809 Palmetto Avenue for the Pacifica Resource Center, including conditions of approval in Exhibit A, and incorporate all maps and testimony into the record by reference.
Okay, Commissioner Evans.
Thanks, Chair, and I gladly second that motion.
Oh. And I was just going to second it.
Excellent, thank you. All right, we've had a motion and a second. Please vote. And that passes unanimously. Congratulations, you have an approved project. Anyone aggrieved by the action of the Planning Commission has 10 calendar days to appeal the decision in writing to the City Council. Okay, on to our next public hearing. It is a subdivision filed by Mike O'Connell, agent for property owner Don Kreisman, for a vesting tentative map to subdivide one existing 11,975 square foot lot located on the 500 block of Brighton Road. And he's going to divide that into two lots of 6,006 square feet and 5,969 square feet. The recommended CEQA status tonight is categorical exemption, and the proposed action for the commission is to approve as conditioned. Staff report, please.
Good evening, Chair and Commissioners. The project before you is for review of a land subdivision only with a vesting tentative map. A vesting tentative map is a particular type of subdivision map which provides additional rights to the applicant in that it allows them to vest a right to develop in the future under today's local regulations. And so it's unique from a regular tentative subdivision map in that a tentative subdivision map only does not provide that vested right and that certainty into the future. The item before you does not include review of any structures. It may be a bit confusing because of what's indicated on the subdivision map, as I'll explain in a moment. But the entitlement that you're reviewing is for the legal subdivision of the land only, without an associated approval for any buildings. The R1 zoning district where the property is located does not require discretionary review for construction of single-family homes in most cases, with the notable exception being the so-called mega home ordinance or homes above a certain threshold as identified in the zoning code. These lots in question were merged in the 1980s. They were originally subdivided in the early 1900s and had a 30-foot lot width. The city went through a widespread merger process of a lot of these old lots that did not conform with the current zoning standard of 5,000 square feet and 50-foot lot width. And so these lots in question were initially separate. They were merged by the city in the 1980s, and the property owner is attempting to subdivide them to create two lots again, except not in a side-by-side configuration like they were previously, in a flag configuration, which has one lot in the front and a narrow flagpole, if you will, on the side to provide access to a lot in the rear. The lots, when they were merged in the 1980s, resulted in only one buildable site, and the property owner with this subdivision is attempting to restore the ability to construct two structures at this site. Staff's analysis of the proposed subdivision map is that it meets all applicable zoning standards, which in this case are primarily limited to lot size and lot width. Since we're not looking at any particular structures, we have to ensure that the lots have a minimum 50-foot lot width, which both do, and a minimum 5,000 square feet of area, which each lot does. Additionally, as required for a vesting tentative map under the city's zoning standards, when such a subdivision is proposed without an associated set of discretionary approvals, such as permits for the structures, the applicant is required to demonstrate the feasibility of development of the lots. And so the applicant has indicated a hypothetical development footprint for a typical single-family structure and demonstrated that a typical structure could be accommodated with the city's lot coverage, setbacks, and height limits. So to that extent, the applicant has shown that on the map and additionally provided information required in the city's subdivision standards for potential architectural renderings. So again, to demonstrate that a particular traditional, acceptable, usable type of structure can be built on the subdivided lots. Overall, staff's assessment of the subdivision was favorable, with the exception of joint driveway and joint utilities as identified in the staff report. Staff had concerns about negative impacts to the neighborhood over the long term. Since there is no homeowners association to manage the common infrastructure, staff was concerned that in the future, over the long run, property owner disagreements could result in a lack of maintenance, which would be detrimental to the aesthetics and the function of the driveway and the utilities. And therefore, staff has included conditions of approval to address and require separate driveways and separate utilities on site. So with that, staff recommends approval of the project as conditioned, with one change to condition number 3 in the attached resolution. Condition number 3 should be changed to indicate that the vesting rights shall last for 1 year beyond recording of the final map, not 2 years as currently indicated. That was a drafting error on staff's part. And so again, condition number 3, should there be a motion to approve, staff requests that condition number 3 be modified to provide vesting rights for 1 year beyond recording of the final map, not 2 years. So that concludes my staff report, and I'm available to answer questions. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, questions for staff. Commissioner Evans.
Thank you, Chair. Just for confirmation's sake, we are not approving any building on this tonight at all then, correct?
That's correct.
Okay. And you said the change to from a shared driveway to two individual driveways, we aren't seeing that on our paperwork, correct?
That's correct.
Okay.
So you'd have to look to condition of approval number 7 in the draft resolution, which describes the changes that staff would use to review the map, should the commission approve the map and include that condition of approval that staff has recommended.
I just want for clarification. Thank you.
Commissioner Clifford.
I was wondering, now, in our drawings, we saw two nice little cottages, one on each of the lots. What's the maximum size that they could present to staff once they have the subdivision approval?
So it's difficult to describe a maximum. There are a number of variables, including the setbacks, height, and lot coverage. Just to give the basic parameters, there is a maximum 40% lot coverage in the R1 zoning district. There is a maximum 35-foot height limit, and the front setback to the structure is 15 feet and 5 feet on the sides and 20 feet in the rear. So there is some room to play with, if you will, to result in larger structures. Sort of the upper limit without review for suitability is based off of the site development permit zoning standards, the mega home standards, if you will. I haven't done the calculation to see what that square footage is, but it's northward of 2,800 square feet. That's sort of where it kicks in for a 5,000 square foot lot. Both of these lots are proposed larger than 5,000 square feet, so you're looking upwards of 2,800 square feet before discretionary review would kick in.
Thank you for that. I also wanted to say that in terms of the condition on the driveway and on the utilities, I fully understand the importance of not having one driveway and one setup of utilities. When I was working in San Francisco many years ago, I was called in to deal with a project that had two houses behind and one house in front, and they ran the sewer wide from the ones in back underneath the one in front. The city of San Francisco was forced to condemn all three houses to get them to agree to fix the sewer where it broke underneath the house in the front. So I don't want to see that happen to anybody here. Thank
you. Just such a scenario staff was hoping to avoid. Thank you for the anecdote.
All right, Commissioner Berenger.
Yeah, I guess my question is, if the applicant just hypothetically is approved this evening, then they would rely on that approval in terms of going forward with their plans, where they would subsequently come back to us with a more precise plan for us to look at. What is the process on that?
So as it stands, should this map be approved by the Planning Commission this evening, there would be no return to the Planning Commission.
So he or she could move forward with this configuration and essentially apply for building permits?
Once the appeal period had expired and the applicant submitted a final map, which staff would check for substantial conformance with the tentative map approved by the commission.
Okay.
And then there are a few other procedural requirements with respect to subdivision improvements and so forth. Subdivision can be as small as this or as large as thousands of units, so it's a wide-ranging term. Our subdivision standards are written for traditionally much larger projects, but technically he needs to go through a couple of intermediate steps with staff procedurally, but substantively he wouldn't have to come back to the Planning Commission for a review.
Okay, because my concern is, after looking at the site this afternoon, is I don't see this type of a configuration anywhere remotely close to this lot. And I have a concern about that, since it seems to be unique, and I don't know that it's unique in a desirable way.
Well, it is uncommon, I will acknowledge that. It is not unprecedented, and it's considered and contemplated in the city's subdivision standards to allow flag lots in certain situations. So not to say that it's appropriate in this case, that's a decision and determination for the commission, but it is something that the city's standards take account for.
Do we have the ability as commissioners to take into consideration compatibility with other configurations within the immediate area or not?
Probably not, unless you can identify evidence of potential harms to the neighborhood character and neighborhood, I'll just say neighborhood character. Largely, this is an exercise in ensuring zoning conformance. And so to that end, they have provided the minimum lot size and they have provided the minimum lot width. So short of evidence that would indicate potential harm to the neighborhood, like staff identified with utilities and driveways, for example, it would be difficult to make a significant change at this stage.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Commissioner Cooper.
Thank you, Chair. I have a question for you in regards to the vesting. If he builds on one of the lots and chooses not to build on the other lot, does that vesting still expire after a year, or is it carried over and stayed for a period of time until he builds? Oof.
I'll take that one. The map is good for 1 year after they've got a final map. That's not true. It's good for 2 years, and it can be extended for another further 3 years. But that's the extent of the final map's duration. It can't be extended beyond that. So that gives you the full length of time that you can build under that map with the vesting conditions.
So if I'm getting this right, then if he goes ahead and builds one unit, and then he waits 5 years, but outside the realm of things, then he actually acts to build to the new building codes and to the new local laws that we would have.
That's correct.
Okay, thank you.
Commissioner Clifford.
Well, one, I want to acknowledge that when I went to push my call button, I pushed the voting button, so that needs to be corrected. And my question is that I noted in the staff report that lot number 4 is having some part of it taken away to be mixed with this other lot. I wanted to know what was left of lot 4 and who owns it, what kind of a issue are we creating there by having now a smaller lot number 4?
Sure, so I don't have the existing subdivision map in front of me, but my recollection is the series of lots in that portion of the neighborhood are all 30 feet wide. So this property includes two lots under the previous subdivision that were merged that were 30 feet in width each, and the westerly 25 feet of lot 4. So the remainder of lot 4, which I believe to be 5 feet in width, is owned by the adjacent property owner, and it is part of the parcel of several thousand square feet, over 10,000 square feet, where an existing single family home was built. So staff's assessment is that it would not create an issue with a sliver parcel or another non-conforming site.
Okay, I don't see any more questions for staff. The applicant wants to come up. He or she has 10 minutes.
Good evening, commissioners, and thank you for your consideration of this project. My name is Don Kreisman. I've lived in Pacifica for 3 years now, renting on Palmetto Avenue. I and my partner are both school teachers. She is teaching fifth grade. I have been substituting and have subbed in all the grade schools here in Pacifica. We love Pacifica, and we want to make our home here. Last summer, we put in bids, offers on three different small two-bedroom houses, but sadly, we're outbid on all three. And just as we were about to give up, I came across this large lot on Brighton, and we bought it last September. Our hope is that we could divide the lot, sell the back lot, and use the funds to pay, help pay for the house on the front lot in which we intend to live on. I am not an investor. I am not a developer. I'm simply trying to find a way to afford a home in Pacifica. We plan to live on the front lot. I think our plan shows how we can take this extremely large lot, which is only 15 feet short on the frontage of being easily divided into two lots. And with this large lot, we can divide it into two lots with a modest, attractive beach cottage on each lot. These homes are very tasteful and will fit in nicely with the surrounding neighborhood. We will be transforming a vacant lot designed for housing with enough space for two houses into two modest new homes that will greatly enhance the neighborhood. It will no longer be a vacant lot, but now two attractive homes with beautiful landscaping. We have made arrangements to build both homes simultaneously as soon as we possibly can. These will be reasonable homes. They will not be McMansions. They will conform to all setbacks, all height, all parking, and all density codes. Staff's recommendation for two separate driveways is completely embraced and will only enhance our project. With me tonight are the project's architect, Brian Brinkman, the contractor, Mike Panese. All three of us would like to make ourselves available should there be need for any clarification or any questions. Again, thank you so much for your consideration.
Mr. Brinkman.
Add a few things. We've already started design on the homes. For the one on the front lot here, it's about 1,700 square foot, and the one in the back is we're not as far along on that one, but it's going to be probably a little under 2,000, probably 1,900 in that area. And I just wanted to point out that with the existing lot at it, as it is at 11,975 square feet, under the mega home ordinance calculations, you could build over a 4,100 square foot house without having to get any approval through here or there. So you could put a large, gigantic house there. And we're proposing two homes that are smaller to them than that total is what we're looking to do. So thank you.
Thank you. Any questions for the applicant? Commissioner Cooper.
Thank you, Chair. I always have questions. I was wondering, either the builder or the homeowner, you know, we always have an issue with the fire department and their access into the back. Have you contacted the fire department and kind of vetted your plan with him and kind of looked at it?
Yeah, we have a 12-foot wide driveway, and we've probably 6-7 years ago, I was a part of another one in which that was what they wanted was the 12-foot.
Great.
So
that's all I need to know. Thank you.
Okay, I don't see any other questions, but stick around. And I'm going to open this up to the public hearing. I've only got one card, and if you wish to speak, please fill one out. You'll have 3 minutes, hand it up to staff. First speaker will be Bridget McKenna.
Hello. I actually live on that block. And it's just a coincidence that I'm here. And actually, I like that idea that he has to make smaller houses, because I think that's the best way to go going into the future, smaller. Rethink our subdivisions, because we don't want to ruin our nature But on the other hand, this is on Gypsy Hill. And Gypsy Hill, I think if everybody remembers, it's a big hill with a lot of trees. And yes, it's privately owned, but I'd like to say that humanity and Earth itself has been constantly at the, you know, constantly being risked for free enterprise. And I think that that period of time in human history is coming to an end, and we're at the wheel that's slowly grinding to an end. But how many more trees, how much more land? These trees create water, they create a watershed. We're in the middle of a devastating drought in California. I understand there's private ownership issues, but those issues can be mitigated if we take into consideration all the expense of losing our environment as Pacifica. I know it's kind of a different idea, but I see the panel is really not a diverse panel. I don't see any women on the panel, and I have to call you on that. I mean, why are there no women on the Planning Commission? It's like 2016. And yes, we think differently, and yes, we think with our hearts, and yes, I think we're needed on your commission.
Okay, next up is John Thom. Tom, sorry.
Thank you. Good evening. I speak in support of the Sharp Park neighbors who oppose the request to subdivide the property on Brighton. While the city's statutes and ordinances and zoning rules may permit this change, they fail to recognize the unintended consequences of crowding more and more into less and less. Perhaps it is because the guiding rules were laid down many years ago and did not foresee the potential adverse effects they would have on the community as it grew and changed. On the other hand, if these guiding rules are recently drawn up, then they are short-sighted in failing to recognize the desires of the members of the Sharp Park community who treasure living here, including the openness we enjoy in the landscape. What is the objection? It is not, repeat not, a challenge to the person or personality of the requesting property owner. Rather, it is the abiding concern that Sharp Park and Pacifica will undergo a building rush that will push people and structures closer together in violation of the kind of neighborhood homeowners, renters expect when they choose Pacifica for their homes. Look at any community in the Bay Area and you find housing, the need for it, and the high prices paid for it as leading concerns of residents. What we are witnessing is a transition to higher living densities in those communities where developments squeeze more properties into an already scarce land resource. Pacifica should be a holdout against this, against further tightening of that density. Without protections, Pacifica will lose its family-friendly reputation. Let's remember that zoning rules are simply technicalities, and if their pages are interpreted in just plain black and white, they will fail to embrace the legitimate desires of the community members who live here. This is an issue that underscores the kind of home and family environment that residents wish to be a part of. I thank you.
Next up, Emily Kay.
Good evening. My name is actually Emily Crustapentis, but it's so long I just figured out. Who needs to know?
Thank you.
I second what Mr. Tom has just said. I live directly across from him at 539 Moana. Mr. Tom lives at 518 Moana. I'm speaking from the heart right now. And for one thing, I would like to know what is considered reasonable, because you said something about a reasonable height, but that doesn't really tell me anything. What is reasonable in your imagination or whatever you have set forth? It's not acceptable to me what you foresee as reasonable. Number two, there's a hugely wonderful, big, beautiful, and I hope it's a heritage tree so it cannot come down. It's on the other side of Mr. Tom's house. Mr. Tom's house is kitty corner to the property. Maybe that's not in question because that's Mr. Guerrero's property. I'm sorry. But anyhow, this property in question, frankly, I've been living here for 15 years in Sharp Park, and I, whatever the law says, that's fine with the law. But to tell you the truth, I don't think that lot is big enough for two houses, two driveways, two garages, etc. If you like shaking hands with your neighbors when you're getting dressed in the morning, I guess that's up to you. But I just can't see it. I think that the proximity is going to be way, way, way too close and narrow for anybody's taste. We've had plenty of consternation in that neighborhood in terms of other building projects that have impeded people's views and the pleasure of looking out one's window while one is doing dishes and having the pleasure of seeing the Pacific Ocean. Yet somebody decided to put up a monstrosity of a structure, and that pleasure was taken away. And the only comment that the person said was, well, I'll paint a picture of the ocean on the side of my house, and then that way you can see. I raised the roof literally on my kitchen. This is 539 in Moana, with the proper permits, et cetera, yada, yada. And my neighbor, neighbors, the Petersons, are directly up above me, and they're up. So yes, they do see the ocean. I see the ocean. When it came time to the little bit of incline that I made on my roof, I was informed, you know, you can go higher. You can go higher. And I said, no, whatever the law says, that's lovely, but I'm not going to go higher because I don't want the Petersons to hate me for the rest of my life. And that's why I didn't go higher. I made a reasonable little incline so I could have more windows, more light for my kitchen. The Petersons and I get along just swell. I ran over there at least 5 times when this kitchen roof was being constructed because I was going to make darn well sure that I was not going to ruin their view. I hear you. Anyway, I really wish that it sounds like the law says this is all well and good, but I think sometimes you have to consider
and
heart, morality, and people, what people have to live with the rest of their lives. Thank you very much for listening. I appreciate
it. Okay, thank you. Okay, next up, Robert Guerrero.
Good evening. I live at 547 Brighton Road. I've been there for 50 years, and to put two places on one lot there, I think you're crowding the neighborhood with more structures. I have heritage trees right on the property line that could be affected by the building going in. I would just hate to see, you know, two monstrosity structures and then, you know, two garages. It's really crowding the lot. And like Emily said, I don't think the lot's big enough for something like that. So thank you.
Thank you. My last card of the night is Martin Piva.
Good evening. I live on 550 Brighton, right across where the lot is going to be developed. We moved to the house in 2012. I can feel my wife is a school teacher at the Thomas Edison in Daly City. She's a humble construction worker as well. So I can take part on what the new owner said about like the hardship of owning a house. Also, I think when we decided to buy our house, we make sure that we could afford it, and it was something that financially we could commit with my wife. We did. We love it. We have our little boy. He's a Pacifican, and I really feel like subdividing that lot, it will set a precedent for everybody else to kind of come with a little bit of money and buy out all these homes and end up splitting our neighborhood that is big and beautiful into just tiny little crummy places that I don't really agree that it's the feel. Like one of the things that I feel like most of the new neighbors and the existing ones have is like these beautiful lots, and you have the place for your little ones to play across the street. No, we know everybody. We don't need to really have a house right next door. I can go to Bob's and say hi every morning when we take the trash, sort of with everybody else. I feel the community itself invite to introduce one another. You don't need to have a house 5 feet from the other one. So I don't feel like it might be the right thing for our neighborhood. And thank you for your time.
I have one more card. Jean. Yes, come on up.
My name is Gene Barden. I live on 540 Moana Way, Sharp Park. And this division of property is going to happen behind my house, slightly down the hill. The house that is next door to me down the hill on Moana turned out when it was built. Well, I'm getting ahead of myself. I had a heritage tree that I planted in my front yard that came in a half gallon tomato can, and it was about that big, and I planted it in the front yard. It became wormy, and I think there were some other problems with it. I don't remember right now, but PG&E kept trimming it, and it was leaning like this toward my house. So I got a tree guy to come out and look at it, and he says, it's got to go. It's going to take the front of your house. I says, okay, I guess we'll have to do that. They went to all of my neighbors. They all said, geez, Gene, what are you going to do with it? What are you doing with a tree? Well, I'm trying to cut it out. Well, it's a heritage tree. Well, it's a big problem. Huh? So I got conversation from a lot of my neighbors. The tree got cut down and taken out. When it was taken out, they said, boy, are you lucky that you did that, because this tree was on the verge of taking your house. But next door down the hill was a single-story house, just like mine. Somebody bought it, and they remodeled it. They moved the front wall out. They moved the back wall out. They went up the view that we used to have out our kitchen window of the ocean and the jet trails going by. That's all gone. When we complained about it to the building department, etc., oh, we don't guarantee a view to anybody in Pacifica. And I finished that meeting when I spoke. I said, well, I sure hope nobody takes the sunsets out of your lives in the sunset of your life, which is the condition that we had. Now, this property coming around, and I know it beeped, I'm supposed to quit, but this property is going to have the two-story houses in order to get the square footage they want. And I'm not sure how much that's going to do to the neighbors up the hill. So I think that some thought should be given to what they're doing to the rest of the neighbors. It sounds like a good idea, but I've got some questions that I would like resolved before it goes ahead. I thank you for my opportunity.
Thank you. Okay, I don't see any more comment cards up here, so I'm going to close public comment. Applicant, do you wish to come up and address some of the comments you heard?
Thank you, I appreciate that, commissioners. In regards to the trees and the one comment about being on Gypsy Hill, property is not really on Gypsy Hill, and the property has, I think, one small tree, not more than 6 inches in diameter. So the first comment, I'm not sure that's relevant to this particular property. The second comment about density, the project conforms to all of the density codes and concepts given by the city of Pacifica. It is not in violation of any of that in terms of single family dwelling or the density codes for this particular property. Also, in terms of neighboring trees that are outside of this property, we have already had a discussion on building within a restrained way to not affect those trees that are not on the property, and have discussed hiring an arborist to ensure that we would not harm any neighbor's trees. In terms of crowding, this property, again, has been noted by the architect, could sustain a huge house by the size of the property, going to 40% of the house, in which, if it was owned by another individual, that could proceed without any knowledge of the Planning Commission and could just be pursued. But as we're dividing the property, our intent is to divide it in a such a way to be sensitive to the neighbors, keeping two small, attractive cottages on a property rather than one huge mega property or mega house, which would definitely detract from the neighborhood. The project is allowable within all of the Pacifica codes and standards. It has actually been approved twice by the planning department because we ended up moving a line just a couple of feet, and so it went through the whole process again, and by their approval are identifying that the project does meet all codes, restrictions, parking, setbacks, heights, all the other codes. And I think, do you have comments, Sue?
Yeah, I just wanted to add a couple quick things also. You know, with concerns of the neighbors, we're proposing a maximum height of 30 feet, which we're going to, you know, even be under that. The footprints are smaller than a Lindemar Rancher. We're only proposing two stories with the second story built partially into the roof to help minimize the size of the structure. And then also the staggering of the lots actually helps it so that neighbors aren't looking directly into each other's windows like was suggested.
Any questions for the applicant? Commissioner Clifford.
Yes, I heard you say that there are no heritage trees on your property. So the tree that's been talked about is a neighbor's tree?
That is correct.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Yeah,
like I said, it's not your property. Okay.
Actually, I had a question for staff, if I could. I don't have a question at this point for the applicant, but a couple of times I've heard, a couple things that I wanted to clarify. One is I heard comment as I was listening to the applicant speak that a larger house on the one parcel that currently exists could be built of right. Is that right? Without discretionary permits, up to something in the neighborhood of 40-something hundred square feet? Is that correct?
I can't speak to the calculation, but certainly, you know, well over 3,000 square feet. Very clearly, it's an 11,975 square foot site. So you can do the math approximately. It's a very large home.
And the other thing I saw in the staff report, I just wanted to clarify, and I think this is along the lines you were commenting on earlier, it's a statement that any potential approval granted for the subdivision will not necessarily limit development to these parameters, discussing the parameters that were in the report. Except as explicitly stated in the conditions of approval. And I heard some comment tonight from the applicants and the applicant's architect that they're already quite a ways down the road in terms of designing the two houses and have some sense of what the square footage would be. Is there any way that the conditions of approval could, in fact, explicitly lay out some parameters along the lines that we've heard tonight?
I'll grab that one.
The subdivision regulations don't actually give any opportunity to address the design of the structure or the massing of the structure and things like that. You're really limited to the things that are raised in the Subdivision Map Act and in the city's subdivision regulations. So while the conditions can relate to subdivision issues, they can't relate to issues having to do with the actual design of the structure.
Okay, thank you.
Commissioner Evans.
Thank you, Chair. Questions for staff again. Number one, I just wanted to confirm the, so if the lots were not divided and somebody were to purchase them or the current owner could come and build a 3,000, 4,000 square foot home without even coming before us, correct?
That's correct.
Okay. I was looking at Google Map and it appears that just about all the other lots have already been subdivided by the placement of homes on there. Do you have any figures on that for that vicinity right there?
I don't have an exact percentage of the number of lots that are developed compared to the number of lots that are vacant. The subdivision is substantially developed. There are very few lots that were apparent to me that are vacant. This is a large lot that is vacant, and so you know, I understand it's a change from what it has been, but it would be consistent with the development pattern of the surrounding subdivision to develop this with two dwelling units or two structures.
And if I heard you correctly, some time ago, it used to be two lots and it was combined to develop this 11,000 square foot lot. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Thank you.
Okay, I don't see any more questions at the moment. I'm going to bring this back to us for deliberation. All right, Mr. Commissioner Berenger.
I'll go first. First of all, I want to say I totally empathize with the applicant's dream. It's a beautiful piece of property. It's in a really nice neighborhood. I spent some time there this afternoon looking at it. I struggle with the manner in which you've approached the subdivision. I understand that there may be some technical issues that you satisfy, but in consideration of how the other properties are developed in the area, I think it's out of character for the rest of the neighborhood. And you know, I while I have a personal opinion on the advantages and disadvantages of building a larger house on that lot as opposed to two smaller houses, you know, the owner of the property should have some flexibility in how they utilize their real estate. But I think to subdivide it for two separate ownerships and the issues that creates and how that in a long-term fashion impacts the neighborhood makes it pretty difficult for me to support this project in its current configuration. I don't know if there's any alternatives that could be available. I suspect there might be, but I have a hard time supporting the project in its current configuration.
Thank you. Commissioner Neblin.
Thank you. I actually am in support of the application. I don't have a particular problem with the flag configuration. I think it's appropriate to the particular circumstances. I'm especially in favor of anything that develops anything that's, you know, I hesitate to call it affordable, but it's maybe the closest we're going to get to affordable, naturally affordable housing. And I think that this is a good opportunity. I don't think it's so far out of character as to offset those considerations. I'd rather see smaller houses built, frankly. So I think in the totality, I'm in favor of it. Again, because I think that we ought to be encouraging everything we can to have this sort of infill development that will generate some housing that is more on the affordable end of things.
Commissioner Clifford.
I have a question for staff. Would it be possible if the lot was not subdivided for them to not only build one home but also an in-law unit on that property?
If the unit was constructed to be completely accessible to persons with disabilities, they could go up to 850 square feet typically it would be a 750 square foot limit for a second dwelling unit.
So there could potentially be two units on that property, irregardless of how this goes tonight.
There could be, but there is a restriction in the city's standards to separately deed a second dwelling unit, in which case the property owner could not sell it to reap the financial benefit that he has indicated is important to his particular situation. But in terms of just dwelling unit comparison, you could construct another dwelling unit on the site without subdividing.
Thank you.
Just a quick question. If that scenario played itself out, how would that impact the main structure, the size of the main structure on the lot?
It likely would not impact it. It's a rather sizable lot, and so it's reasonable to expect that they could situate a second dwelling unit without a drastic change to the footprint indicated in the subdivision map, but that specific analysis would have to be performed.
So, in other words, you could still have the 4,100 square foot home and the in-law unit on that size lot?
I can't speak to that. I don't know.
Let's see, Commissioner Evans.
Thank you, Chair. I am overall in favor of it for a different reason. We have had in front of us many, many, I've been on this commission for a while, and many homes have come before us that were large. And anywhere, as co-commissioner said, anywhere we can even get close to having an affordable house, I will jump at that. And these two small homes, if I wasn't mistaken, are like 1,000 square feet or something like that. That to me, that is in the line of affordable, rather than a 4,100 square foot home that's going to be multi-million. So I'm in favor of that. I also look on the plot map and see the plot divisions of the other lots, and knowing that our standard in Pacifica is 5,000 square foot for a lot, this is well over two lots in size. So I don't have a problem with it. I understand the neighborhood, and I truly feel for that, seeing that there's only a couple lots left on that street. But again, I come back to the fact that we have people who own property, and we should not keep them from the rights of doing something with it. So I'm going to go back to my old statement on that point, and I would be, in favor of this. I won't say reluctantly, but I understand the plight of the neighbors, so I'll leave it at that.
Commissioner Gordon.
Let's see. I love the discussion that we're having. I think I want to correct some statements that have been made, because I don't think they're correct. In terms of the discussion about the desirability of affordable housing and how this potentially meets that need, all that we're there's nothing that restricts the person, the applicant, from, I think, going up to, what, 2,800 square feet or so before any kind of discretionary review comes in on each. If the subdivision is approved, then I understand that the applicant has suggested that they might build a house that's 1,500 square feet or blah, blah, blah. But I don't think that it's fair for us to, it's accurate for us to discuss this project in terms of oh boy, this is going to result in affordable housing, because the fact is that if we were to approve this, there's nothing that would keep the applicant from building two 2,800 square foot homes. And, you know, our understanding of Pacifica housing prices, that's not necessarily, that wouldn't necessarily result in an affordable house. I'm not saying that I'm in favor or against this project, but I am in favor of just us having, I want to refine the discussion that we're having, so that you know, goals, some of the goals that are being discussed here wouldn't really be fulfilled if we were to vote in favor of this project.
I think I'm gonna just jump in because I haven't had a chance yet. I wanna actually echo what Commissioner Gordon just said, because I don't necessarily think this will result in affordable housing. It could, but it could not. And I'm really not willing to sacrifice community character, hillside preservation, and other important goals of the general plan in the city on the altar of affordable housing. I think that takes you down a slippery slope, and I think there's a lot of adjoining cities we don't want to look like in the future that have, I think, have done that with kind of an anything goes approach. Anyways, right now it's a close call, because for me, the community character, I think a lot of that deals with expectations. And if you've driven up in that neighborhood, I dare you to find too many folks who live up there who expect this type of lot split. Does it affect the community character or not? Wrestling with that right now. I'd like to hear from my fellow commissioners. Commissioner Neblin.
Thank you. I just wanted to clarify again. I think affordable is, I mean, we're not really talking about affordable. We're not talking about housing that's affordable to people of very low or moderate income. I think we can all stipulate to that. So as I was using that term, I was, I guess, trying to speak relative to a 40-something 100 square foot home. A couple of homes that are perhaps half that size are, in my mind, more affordable than one that is massive, more massive. So again, if I was suggesting that I was trying to use that term in any technical sense, I want to make really clear that I certainly wasn't. I don't know that, in my view, the proposal is so far afield of kind of community standard that we're sacrificing some of the interests that I think you quite rightly raised. So I want to make sure that is stated for the record as well. But again, I really just wanted to clarify. Again, affordable housing has a very specific meaning, which I don't really, I think, we are using when we're talking about this particular project, and I'll stipulate that.
Thank you, Commissioner Cooper.
Thank you, Chair. I'm just speaking up because I think it's important that the Commission understands at least where I sit on this project. I think looking at it and looking at the other homes that are around there, I genuinely think that parcel could end up blowing up to a 4,000, 5,000 square foot house plus a huge garage plus an Airbnb on top. I mean, it could be a huge development. And a lot of the conversation that I heard today is I don't want any obstructed views. I don't want any building. I don't want anything on the property. And I don't think that's fair to the person who owns the lot. I think that they should have a right to build on that lot and enjoy Pacifica just as much as I have enjoyed Pacifica. You know, I think that the community in general could use houses that are more affordable than a 4,000 or 5,000 square foot house that is purely out of the realm of people who are working the public service environment. So as much as I hear this, you know, the residents not wanting anything on the build, I think it could be a real negative thing if there was a huge home on top of that. So I kind of like what he's saying. Am I confident that he'll build below the 2,700 square foot? You know, he said he's coming here to build and he's gonna sell one of the lots, and I heard from the builder, I can't guarantee it, nor can I put it in the planning in this proposal, but in general, I think I would be for this particular proposal.
Commissioner Clifford.
Well, I know I'm clear that tonight what we're voting on is a subdivision and not any form of housing. And, you know, I think that definitely needs to be stated. If we're going to talk about housing, it's also clear to me that subdividing keeps both of those lots from having any large home on them. So I think that now that I've said that, again, the housing part of this is not actually what we're deciding tonight. We're simply deciding whether or not to move forward with the subdivision of that lot. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm not seeing any lights on, at least from, I guess, I'll say one more thing. It seems that, I guess, we'd have more comfort, some of us would have more comfort if we knew, had more certainty as to what these houses look like and the setbacks and how big they were. Probably be a much easier task up here to make this decision if the tentative, I mean, if the subdivision map came with the actual plans. Is that possible? Is that something you, counselor, is that something you've seen in other areas?
No, really here, the way that the zoning is written for this area, there is no discretionary review required to build a home. So the subdivision map is not an opportunity to graft those requirements into the code. It's really just, it's been a legislative decision of the city that that sort of discretionary review won't happen when these projects go to get built. So unfortunately, no, the answer is you can't import them in.
No, but you, just out of curiosity, you couldn't, could you bring in a separate action on, in addition to the tentative, in addition to the subdivision map, could we have had a joint application for some sort of housing element that would specify size?
I suppose it's always possible that the applicant could choose to include in their application for the subdivision what they would be putting forth, but they're certainly not required to. And so in this particular case, all they were required to do was to provide an illustration that development on these lots was feasible. And that's what the illustration in your packet shows. But they haven't chosen to give you some sort of design of what they're agreeing to build. And the commission can't require that through the conditions of approval.
Thank you. You've answered my question, and that's great. It's not something that's required, but is possible. It's discretionary with the applicant.
It's within their discretion, and it would be something that they, it would not be something that the commission could condition the project on.
Correct. Thank you.
And I just wanted to point out, if an applicant chose to do that with a subdivision in an R1 district where single family homes permitted, and say their circumstances changed, jobs going to move them back east, there's no requirement for a subsequent owner to build what that applicant showed you or showed the commission. And staff would have no ability through our codes to require them to come back to the planning commission. So I just wanted to be clear there that if a subdivider chose to do that, even if it wasn't their intent, something could happen and the design could completely change without coming back to the planning commission.
Thank you. That's an important clarification. All right. Commissioner Nevlin.
Well, not to cut off any conversation on this, but I'm ready to make a motion. Let's see if we can get a second for it. I'd like to move that the Planning Commission find that the project is exempt from the California Environmental Quality Act, that the Commission approve the vesting tentative map SUB 23216 by adopting the attached resolution, including conditions of approval in Exhibit A, with the modification to Condition 3 allowing vesting rights for 1 year, and incorporate all maps and testimony into the record by reference.
And before I give the second, I just want to say this is a close call for me. One of the things that I think has been important for me to understand is that it looks like you could have two structures here anyway, an in-law unit, and also you could have a very large home. So it's one of those, be careful what you ask for. We've certainly seen those. Okay, I'm going to take the second. Commissioner Clifford?
I second this motion.
Okay, and okay, we've had a motion and a second. Please vote. Okay, that passes. Congratulations. You have an approved project. Anyone aggrieved by the action of the Planning Commission has 10 calendar days to appeal the decision in writing to the City Council. Okay, next up, consideration items. Gonna wait one moment for folks to clear out, but the first consideration item involves the Library Advisory Committee appointment. The proposed action tonight is to appoint one of us to the Library Advisory Committee. Staff report, please.
Good evening. So this appointment to the library, newly formed Library Advisory Committee, was before you in January, and due to new appointments to the Planning Commission, the Commission is asked to appoint a new member to represent them on the Library Advisory Commission.
Thank you. And this is a preliminary matter. Former Commissioner Sue Vaterlaus was the designee, and I want to note that fact, and I'd very much appreciate her volunteering for that at the time. Commissioner Clifford.
I would at this time like to volunteer for that position. I'm a strong advocate of the library. I'm also a senior, which the impact on seniors is pretty high. And third, I'm also have built in the area that's proposed for the building of the library and know some of the conditions there that need to be met too. So anyway, I could wear many hats at the Library Advisory Commission.
Commissioner Neblin.
I'd actually like to nominate Commissioner Campbell, who at the last go-around on this had expressed some strong interest in this position. I'm assuming that, assuming he's still willing to serve, it was only because Commissioner Vaterlaus had expressed interest that I had gone a different direction, but I think Commissioner Campbell would make a fantastic designee.
Is Commissioner Campbell interested?
I think that, thank you very much, and this is true, I was interested at that time. I have to acknowledge the fact that Commissioner Clifford probably brings at this point more to the table than I do in that area, and I will reluctantly again step out, but very much appreciate the nomination. Anyone else interested? Okay, do we vote? Mm-hmm. Let's vote.
Motion?
Oh, let's make a motion. Why not? Okay, Commissioner Cooper.
I nominate Commissioner Clifford to be the designee to the Library Advisory Committee.
Commissioner Evans.
I'll second that.
Had a motion, a second. Please vote. Unanimous. Congratulations. Thank you for volunteering.
You're welcome.
Next up, reorganization of the Planning Commission. Proposed action, motion to elect a chair and vice chair. I won't accept a nomination for chair again. No. Nominated, I will not serve. Anyways, I think the line of succession here is that, and I think I'm clear on this, is that normally I think the vice chair would be, from my perspective, nominated as the chair, and then we would move on to next in line for the vice chair. Vice chair being Commissioner Gordon. That's who I would nominate. Commissioner Evans.
I would like to nominate Commissioner Josh Gordon for chair.
Commissioner Cooper.
I'll second the motion.
Okay, I don't see any other lights. Let's have a vote. Unanimous.
Thank you.
All right. Congratulations, new chair, Commissioner Chair Gordon. Next up would be vice chair, and I think in the lines of succession here, it's not quite as clear. We have, if I'm correct, two commissioners who were appointed at the same time, Nebelin and Cooper. It would have been Commissioner Vaterlaus as well, I think, but. Commissioner Clifford, is that a stale light?
Yes, I was ready to nominate somebody if you're ready to give up the mic.
Oh. Wow. Okay. Commissioner Clifford.
I would like to nominate Commissioner Nebelin.
Thank you.
Commissioner Gordon.
I'll second that.
Okay. We've had a motion and a second. Please vote. Unanimous passage. Congratulations, Vice Chair Nebelin.
Thank you.
I'd like to note that that was a close call, actually. Two very good applicants. So there we have it. Before I relinquish the mic, I do want to, at this point, because I don't want to forget, thank Commissioner Vaterlaus, who would have been in the running here, for her service over the last year. Definitely. And just really want to express that heartfelt thanks. Next up, Commission Communications. Commissioner Gordon.
Thank you, Chair. I definitely want to thank Commissioner Sue Vaterlaus for her service on the commission. It was wonderful to have her as a colleague. I was sad to see her go. Also, at the same time, welcoming new blood, Commissioner Berenger, onto the commission. It's wonderful to have you. And Commissioner Clifford does not qualify as new blood. But it's really great to see you back again as well. So anyway, and thank you all for nominating me for chair. Anyway, but looking forward to a fun term.
All right, Commissioner Evans.
Thank you, Chair. I too, as with Commissioner Gordon, want to thank Sue Vaterlaus for the year of service, and I will also miss her on the commission. I thought she added a lot to the commission. But I also want to welcome back Commissioner Clifford, welcome back, and welcome our newcomer. So welcome aboard and enjoy.
Okay, Commissioner Nebelin.
I similarly just wanted to thank Sue for her service and welcome to the new commissioners. I have to say we have a really, really sharp dialogue here, sharp in the sense that just really well construed and really well put together. And I think it's owing to the brain power of the people that I work with.
Commissioner Clifford, is this stale or no?
Well, first, I also want to thank Sue for her many years of service here on this commission. She worked really hard for everybody, and it should be acknowledged. Also, I wanted to bring up for staff to consider at some time in the next year, rewriting the bylaws. Right now, the way the bylaws are set, the reorganization is supposed to take place at the last meeting in December. And I had a chance to relook at the bylaws when they were given to me anew. And I think that since we are now clearly doing the reorganization after the yearly appointments, it would behoove us to have our bylaws match what we're actually doing. Thank you.
Commissioner Gordon.
Thank you, Chair. And I forgot to say one thing. I wanted to thank Chair Campbell for his excellent chairmanship during the past year.
Thank you. Thank you. I was about to thank my fellow commissioners for being such a great commission. I think the last vote we just had on that lot split really kind of exemplifies the give and take and the educative approach that we take to things. I think mine's changed up here as a result of the deliberation and clarification. So I'd also like to thank staff for supporting this commission for the last year. Thank you so much for the great staff reports. It's been very, very easy to sit up here with these staff reports in hand, so thank you.
One more.
Oh, Commissioner Cooper.
It would behoove me if I did not thank Sue as well. I mean, I think that it was very, she was very educational and brought a lot of experience to the commission. There was one comment that was made, I think, for people who are watching, that we don't appoint ourselves to the Planning Commission. So if there's diverse, I heard a diversity issue, I heard a bunch of other things, and really that's up to the City Council and the Mayor to appoint people. So I just wanted to clarify that.
Important clarification. Thank you. One other thing while I've got the mic and I'm still chair. about 5 years ago, we had a joint meeting with the North Coast County Water District, which I thought was really informative and really necessary. And as we head into a period of drought and also perhaps some big subdivisions coming online some other issues, I think it would be a great thing to have another meeting like that. I think it's been a while, and I remember it being well attended and really worth doing. So I don't know if there's a way to set that up. I'd encourage it.
Just a clarifying question. So that it was City Council and North Coast, or was it Planning Commission and North
Coast? It was City Planning and North Coast.
City Council, Planning, and North
Coast. I believe that was what it was, yeah.
Okay.
All three.
So the bodies that have land use authority.
Exactly, with the Planning Commission being the most issues. Important and paramount body.
Sorry, John.
Sorry, Mr.
Oh, he's right there.
Right there. Okay. Next, unless I have any other commission communications, staff communications.
Just a quick update on staffing. So Catherine retired as of last week, so she's ridden off into the sunset. So we wish her the best in her retirement. And assistant planner recruitment is ongoing, and hopefully we'll have some more bodies on soon for you guys to meet. And then I just wanted to address Commissioner Clifford's comment about the reorganization. So the bylaws do need to be updated, and when the council reorganized all of the commissions and committees, they changed the reorganization month to April. So that's why we're doing it now, but the bylaws do certainly need to be updated. So thank you for that.
Okay. Commissioner Gordon.
Move to adjourn.
Okay. Do we have a second? All right. Commissioner Neblin.
Second.
All right, we've had a motion by new Chair Gordon and a second by new Vice Chair Neblin. Please vote.
They'll die. Yeah.
Unanimous. Thank you.
Excellent.
Good night.
All right.
Get the second half of this game.
Yes.
Awesome.
Yeah. I tried to make sure that you fell over.
I'm sorry about that. I didn't mean to roll over your paper. There.